Hello, welcome to GYAS. How are you? I hope you are doing well. So friends, as you know that on our channel, we are covering the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services. And for that purpose, we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So currently, we have 12 series that target your prelims and one series that target your mains, including one more series on which we cover your history optional syllabus through via test means. So in these prelims oriented series, that is 12 series, what we do, we daily cover two topics, and in this manner, in 6 days, we cover your 12 series. So we have broadly divided your whole syllabus of UPSC into 12 subtopics. So daily we pick up two topics, subtopics, and we discuss the MCQs of these topics. And in this manner, we daily cover two subtopics. And in 6 days, approximately 12 subtopics are completed. And in this manner, this process continues on and on. So we will continue to do so till 31st May. So why the date chosen has been 31st May? Because on 2nd June is your prelims of UPSC CSE 2019. So let's start our discussion of today's lecture, friends. So today we will be discussing the economy lecture number 4. So in it, we will be discussing your MCQs of economy. So let's start our discussion. The first question is, as per the provisions of Consumer Protection Act 1986, first, consumer protection councils are to be established by the central governments, and second is central and state government. Second is a consumer disputes redressal forum known as district forum is to be established by state government in each district. So we have to choose that which of the above statements is correct. Let me tell you, friends, that both of these statements are correct. So the Consumer Protection Bill Act 1986, it creates three-tier structure for the redressal of consumer grievances, and thus three-tier structure is like this central consumer protection council at the central level, and then at the state level comes your consumer protection council of state level, and then at district level comes your district forum. So this three-tier structure is created. So the answer is both 1 and 2. Let me tell you, friends, that recently the government of India had introduced a bill in relating to the consumer protection, relating to consumer protection, in which certain amendments were proposed, but it was not passed. So the answer is C, that is both 1 and D, both 1 and 2. So solution is C. So here is the justification. You can see here, the central council shall consist of following members, namely Ministry of Charge of Consumer Affairs in the central government, who shall be its chairman, and such other members that are official or non-official and representing the interest as may be prescribed. So each district forum shall consist of a person who is or has been or qualified to be a district judge, who shall be its president, and two other members, one of whom shall be a woman. So this is about your first question. Let's move on to the second question. So learning is that locally they are known as consumer forums or consumer protection council. So they guide consumers on how to file cases in the consumer court. So let's move on to the second question. Second question is, consider the following about additional tier 81 bonds. So we have to consider these statements. First, they combine both debt and equity. Second, they are issued under Basel III capital regulations. Which of the above statements is correct? Let me tell you, friends, that both of these statements are correct. These additional tier 81 bonds, they are issued under Basel III capital regulations, and they combine both debt and equity. So they are high risk type of bonds. The defining characteristic of these bonds, that is additional tier 1 bonds, or they are also referred to as COCOs bond, is that they can be converted into shares when certain conditions are met. So 81 bonds are hybrid bonds combining both debt and equity. So for example, this, when a company runs into trouble, the owner lose their stake and the debt becomes equity. But in case of banks, such negotiations are not possible. So this is all about your statement. Let's move on to the next question. Third question is, consider the following about anti-dumping duty. First, it is imposed on both imports and exports. Second, it is against the World Trade Organization multilateral trade rules. Third, in India, it is imposed by Union Finance Ministry. So we have to choose the correct statement. So friends, let me tell you, friend, this is not imposed on exports. So first statement is clearly wrong, and second is also wrong because it is not against against the WTO multilateral trade rules. But yes, third is correct. In India, it is imposed by Union Finance Ministry. So here is an important point to be considered, that it is recommended by your Union Ministry of Commerce, but it is imposed by Union Finance Ministry. So only third statement is correct. So the answer is C, that is third only. So here is the explanation. Justification is that anti-dumping is a trade levy imposed by any government or imported products which have prices less than their normal values in the domestic market, and it is a protectionist tariff that seeks to stop dumping process where companies exports a product at a price lower than price it normally charged in domestic matter market of importing countries. So let's move on to your next question. Consider the following about Pension Regulatory and Development Authority of India. First, it is a statutory body. Second, it functions under the department under the aegis of Department of Personnel. Third, it regulates all mutual funds which trade in pension and products. We have to choose the correct statement. Let me tell you, friends, that yes, it is a statutory body created under 2003 Act of this specially created Act for the establishment of Pension Fund Regulatory and Development Authority. So first is correct, but let me tell you, friends, that it doesn't come under the aegis of Department of Personnel, but it comes under the Department of Financial Services. This is under the Ministry of Finance. So second is clearly wrong. Regarding third statement, third statement is also wrong, friends, because currently those mutual funds that which trade in pension products, they are regulated by your this Securities and Exchange Board of India, and it doesn't regulate all mutual funds which trade in pension products. So here the only statement that is correct is first, that is it is a statutory body. So here is, you can say, here is this here the answer would be C, that is one only. So here is the justification, you can see it. So it is a statutory body established in 2003 under this PFRDA Act, and it functions under the aegis of Union Ministry of Finance, Department of Financial Services, and promotes old age income security by establishing, developing and regulating pension funds. So this is about your explanation part. So let's move on to the next question. Fifth question is, a double tax avoidance agreement signed between two nations help? First, reduce base erosion and profit shifting by corporate firms. Second, tackle round tripping of money. Third, move towards a complete ban on speculative activities of financial institutional investors in security markets. So we have to choose the correct statement. Let me tell you, friends, that basically a double tax avoidance agreement is signed between two countries, two nations, to avoid double taxation or to eliminate double taxation, which a company or a firm that is operating in both the countries that can face. So in this manner, if it faces your double tax, then it adversely affects their profitability, and they try to avoid the tax. So in order to do away with this double tax avoidance agreement is signed. So it reduces the base erosion and profit shifting by corporate firms, as well as it tackles the round tripping of money, but it doesn't impose complete ban on speculative activities of financial institution investors. Basically, the purpose of the regulation on your speculative activities of FIIs is to kind of bring in more transparency, but ultimately the work of institutional investors is to speculate, so you can't completely ban it. So third is clearly incorrect. So one and two only is correct. So the A answer is the correct answer. Solution is A. So here is the explanation given to you. So firms that operate in two nations simultaneously must pay taxes in both, but it would cause a huge loss for them. So firms generally avoid taxes to reduce their tax liability. So to do away with this, it is this DTAA is signed. So here is the explanation. Let's move on to the sixth question. Sixth question is, public debt in India is presently managed by A, Reserve Bank of India, B, Securities and Exchange Board of India, C, Unified Financial Agency, D, Department of Posts. Let me tell you, friends, that the correct answer is A, that is Reserve Bank of India. So public debt in India is managed by Reserve Bank of India, but there has been talk to establish a separate agency for the servicing of India's public debt, so that the huge amount of interest payments that India has to pay they can be more effectively tackled so that the servicing of your public debt takes place in effective manner, leading to reduction in the interest payment. So the solution is A, that is currently it is regulated by Reserve Bank of India, but it is proposed that the government of India had also constituted a committee, a specialized committee that was to look into this issue. So in 2016, so public debt in currently it is managed by Reserve Bank of India, but some there is opinion that there must be a specialized agency to service India's public debt. So this is about your sixth question. Let's move on to the seventh question. The seventh question is, the classification of industries in micro, small and medium categories is done on the basis of A, investment in plant and machinery, B, extent of geographical coverage, C, number of people employed, D, rural versus urban location. Let me tell you, friends, that the correct answer is investment in plant and machinery. So the A is the answer. So how we do the classification, how do we classificate micro, small and medium enterprises? So basically there is an act that is Micro, Small, Medium Enterprises Development Act 2006, in which there is a categorization of industries into micro, small and medium categories. So a micro company is that which it is that firm which has a profit of sorry machinery of an investment of below 25 lakh, and after 25 lakh to 5 crore comes the your small industries, and 5 crore to 10 crore comes your medium industry. So the solution is A, investment in plant and machinery. So here is the explanation. So I have already provided you the explanation. So these micro, small and medium enterprises are classified further into two classes, that is manufacturing and services, and this manufacturing sector is classified by their investment that is below 20 lakh, 25 lakh it constitutes micro enterprises, but between 25 lakh and 5 crore it constitutes your small enterprises, and 5 crore to 10 crore constitutes your medium enterprises. So this is about your seventh question. Let's move on to the eighth question. Eighth question is, consider the following about Global Hunger Index. First, it is released on annual basis by the Food and Agricultural Organization of the United Nations. Second, a score of 0 on Global Hunger Index implies absolute food deprivation in the nation. Third, the Green Global Hunger Index also includes the performance of major nutrition programs in its calculation. Fourth is, India was ranked 103rd out of 119 countries in Global Hunger Index 2018. So we have to choose the correct answer. Let me tell you, friends, that the correct answer is four only, that is fourth only. So India was recently the Global Hunger Index was released in 2018 and India was ranked 103. So its score was 31.1 with a level of hunger that is serious as per this Global Hunger Index 2018. Let me tell you, friends, it is not released by Food and Agricultural Organization. So one is clearly wrong. Second is also wrong, because a score of 0 means zero hunger, and a score of 100 means worst level of hunger. So it doesn't include the performance of major nutrition programs in its calculation. So only the fourth statement is correct. So the answer is A. Solution is A. So here you can see the justification. So basically it is released annually by International Food Policy Research Institute since 2006, and it is not released by this Food and Agricultural Organization. And about this, it ranks on a 100 point scale. 0 on the scale is best score and 100 is the worst score. So fourth statement is this suffers it that is India currently suffers from a higher level of hunger that is serious. So let's move on to the ninth question. Ninth question is, duties credit script is one of the most important export promotion incentive provided by the government and present to exporters. What is a duty credit script? A, it is a pass that allows the holder to import commodities by not paying a specified amount in import duties. B, it is an explicit subsidy that is granted in proportion to the value added to the products by exporters. C, it is a corporate tax exemption granted to export processing units. And D is, it is a subsidized credit that allows exporters to dump products at a cheaper price abroad. So we have to choose that what is meant by duty credit script. So let me tell you, friends, that this duty credit script is basically a pass that allows the holder to import commodities by not paying a specified amount in import duties. So it is one of the most important components of your foreign trade policy 2015 to 2020. So it provides a kind of tax incentive to exporters by kind of reducing import duties on to a certain level for these exporters. So the answer is A. So So here is the explanation. So they are issued to exporters and they allow deduction, non-payment of taxes of a specified amount in the scrip, and the scrip or value or the amount of tax deduction will be specified in the scrip, and the value or tax is expressed as export turnover of the exporter. And the scrip value usually varies 3% to 5% under the Foreign Trade Policy 2015. So let's move on to the 10th question. 10th question is the twin balance sheet challenge and twin deficit often see in news include which of the following economic variables? First, current account deficit. Second, fiscal deficit. Third, external debt. Fourth, banking profits. Let me tell you, friends, the correct answer is correct statements are 1, 2, and 4. Third is not part of it. So the answer here would be 1, 2, and 4 would be. This is B answer. Solution is B. So basically, what is this twin balance sheet problem? Basically, during the India's when the India's economy was seeing a boom, there were lot of corporates that borrowed heavily from the public sector banks, and public sector banks provided them the loans. But ultimately, after this reduction in growth, these corporate firms they were not able to service their debt. So they kind of the loan payments were not serviced to the banks. So in this way, their balance sheets were adversely affected, and this in turn affected the balance sheet of banks, because banks were ultimately dependent upon their profits on the servicing of their debts and the availability of money, and then their further lending. But when the loans were not repaid to the banks, they were not able to lend the money and their profits were reduced. So they were also incurring loss. So in this manner, both the balance sheets of public sector banks as well as the corporates who had borrowed loan from banks were in adverse situation. So this situation is called twin balance sheet problem. So this is all about, friends, today's lecture. If you like the video, if you like the question, then you can then please do share it with your friends and ensure that you subscribe to our channel. And also, friends, do not forget to press the bell icon, because then only you will get all the important notifications relating to UPSC CSE 2019. So friends, let me tell you that if you want to subscribe to the PDFs of these MCQs, you can contact us at this email ID, that is achieveies21@gmail.com, or you can also call us at this number, that is 8968426481. So this is a WhatsApp number. You can contact us at this number also. So certainly there will be a minimum fee structure for the subscription of PDFs, but it has been kept at as low as possible so that you people can afford it. So the purpose of these PDFs is being a paid subscription is that we also remain motivated to help you people. So if you wish to join these MCQs PDFs, then you can contact us at this email ID, or for that matter at this contact number 8968426481. So this is all about, friends, today's lecture. If you like the video, like the lecture, then please do like it, share it with your friends. Thank you, friends. Have a very nice day. Thank you very much.